Hi, this is Professor Kleitz, and in section 12 we're going to talk about the ASCII code, the American Standard Code for Information Interchange. And you may have thought, how do we get, besides just numbers, what about all the letters and the symbols? You know, the letter M, the letter T, the dollar sign, the percent sign, and so on. So there's been a code developed, and it's actually a 7-bit code, and with 7 bits you can have 128 possible different combinations. So let's take a look at the ASCII chart. Okay, so the ASCII chart, the American Standard Code for Information Interchange, is made up of a 3-bit string with a 4-bit string. So example, the null character, these are just special control characters for your keyboard and for your printer. The null character is 0000 in the most significant bits, and then the LS bit is 0000, the least significant bit is 00. So this would be 7 different zeros. Let's take a look at the capital letter D, for example. Capital letter D would start out with a 100, and then you go over to this location, 0100. So the capital letter D is a 7-bit string, and if you talk about this in hexadecimal, this would be worth a 4, and this would be worth a 4. So D is actually a 44 in hexadecimal. So in example 21 and 22, I'm saying if you have this string, 100 and 0111, what is that code? So go ahead and flip back to the previous page and look that up. Make sure you see it's a capital letter G. And then go back to table 1-5 and tell me what the ASCII code is going to be for a lowercase letter P. And when you look that up, here's the string. And a lot of times, often a leading zero is placed to form an 8-bit string. So P, you just put that leading zero on there. And also, a lot of times we'll write this in hexadecimal. This would be a 7-0. Okay, so finally in section 13, we'll look at several different applications of these different numbering systems. One method of creating alternative energy, and maybe you've heard of this, is the geothermal electricity generation. What this is they take the temperature differential either in the earth or in a large body of water or in the ocean, and you actually can extract energy from the differential in temperature. One big key element to geothermal is storing the different water temperature levels in different storage tanks. So here what I'm trying to show is, let's say we have 4 different storage tanks, and in each tank we have 2 sensors. So tank D is going to have a pressure sensor and a temperature sensor. Now pressure is going to sense how much pressure there is in this tank, and if it gets too high it could actually cause a problem, and if it's too low it could be a problem. So we have some sort of a on-off switch is going to say the pressure is high or not, or the temperature is high or not. And we have 4 different tanks, so basically we have 8 different inputs. These all come down into a computer monitoring system. The most significant bit is the pressure in tank D. The next bit is the temperature in tank D. The least significant bit on the right here is the temperature in tank A, and so on. If you lay that out in an 8-bit chart like I did in figure B, the TA would sit here in the LS bit, and the PD would sit in the MS bit. So what we're going to do is I'll look at several different combinations of ones and zeros, and you have to tell me what it is, a high temperature or high pressure. For example, if I said this string had the number 02 in it in hexadecimal, 0 would be 0000 and the 2 would be 0010, that means we have a high pressure in tank A. So let's look at the applications coming up right now. So the first question I ask is, if the computer reads the binary string 0010100, what problems exist? So you have to flip back to the chart in figure 7B, and it will show you that tanks C and B are dangerously high, have high pressures. So flip back to that chart, make sure you see that, tanks C and D pressures. What problems exist if the computer is reading 55? Well, 55 in hex looks like this string. That means that all temperatures are high. Is that right? Flip back, make sure you see that. Part C, what hex number is read by the computer? So now I'm asking it backwards. I'm saying, what if the temperature and pressure in both tanks D and B are high? So I'm not going to solve this for you. Go back and check this out and figure this out yourself. In part D, tanks A and B are taken out of use and their sensor outputs are connected to ones. A computer programmer must write a program to ignore these new circuit conditions. So this happens a lot of time. If a tank is taken out of use, you can either ground the terminal, making it a zero, or you could tie it to 5 volts, making it a high. In this case, we're tying it to ones. The computer program must check that the value read is always less than what decimal equivalent would no problem exists. So flip back to that diagram, take tanks A and B and put ones on all their sensors. If so, you'll see the solution is anything less than 31 is going to be the answer, because with the 4 low order bits high, if the temperature in tank C goes high, then the string would become, you would get this high right here, which is equal to 31. So basically anything less than 31 is going to indicate that no problem exists. In another area of the plant, only 3 tanks, A, B, C, have to be monitored. What octal number? Now we're looking at octal because we've got, with 3 tanks, we'll have 6 inputs, so that lends itself nicely to octal. What octal number is read if tank B has a high temperature and pressure? And I'll leave this up to you to solve this one. So there's 5 more applications of numbering systems. In this one, I'm saying, let's say we had a particular brand, a CD player, that has capability of converting 12-bit signals from a CD into an equivalent analog value. So this is going to be a 12-bit binary number. The question is going to be, what are the largest and smallest hex numbers that can be used in this CD system? And I'm not even going to talk about the solution. Take a look at this and see if you can see how I got that answer. How many different analog values can be represented by this system? And I'm going to skip to the next application. Make sure you can solve that one. Application 3. Typically, digital thermometers use BCD, binary coded decimal, to drive their digit displays. How many BCD digits are required to drive a 3-digit thermometer? What 12 bits are sent to the display for the temperature of 147? Of course, that's base 10. What would that code be? Most personal computer compatible computer systems use a 20-bit address code. This number could be 20, it could be 24. They're getting larger and larger on these address codes. But anyway, if it's a 20-bit address code to identify each of over a million possible memory locations inside the PC, how many hex digits are required to identify the address of each memory location? Part B, what is the 5-digit hex address of the 200th memory location? Let me help you with this one for a second. What's the 5-digit hex address of the 200th memory location? First of all, you have to convert 200 over to hex. That would be a C8. So why did I write C7 as the answer? And of course, it's a 5-bit hex address, so you got to put all 5 hex digits. Why did I use C7? Because the first memory location is 0000. So if there's 200 locations, the first one is 0, so we really only have to have C7 more locations after that. So that is the 200th location would be labeled C7. Part C, if 50 memory locations are used for data storage starting at location C8, what's the location of the last data item? So the answer is F9, and the way I got that was I took a C8, which is really the number 200, we already found that, and we got to add 50 to that, so it's a 250th location, but you have to take away 1 again, so the answer is 249. 249, when you convert that, that's an F9. So I write it here. We had to subtract 1 because location C8 received the first data item, so we only needed 49 more memory spaces. So this is one of the tricky parts of looking at computer memory, is where does it start and where does it end? Do you subtract 1 from your answer or add 1? There will be several more of these types of problems at the end of the chapter. So in application 5, let's say we had a part number that was going into some sort of inventory control, and the part number was 651-M. If you're going to store that in ASCII, list the binary contents, and then at the final, in the end, I'm going to actually list them out in hexadecimal too. So what you need to do is look this up yourself without looking at the answer and see if you get the same answer I get at the bottom of the page. And finally, the last application, 1-6, somebody wrote a program in BASIC. It could be written in C or Java or any other language too. These are going to actually go in as hexadecimal codes. And I'm saying the codes that got listed out when somebody did a what's called a core dump or a memory dump, they look at the codes that are inside the computer and they see 474F54, blah, blah, blah. Assume that the leftmost bit of each ASCII string is padded with a 0 and decode this. Tell me what the message is that's inside the computer that would generate this code. So I'm not going to tell you the answer, it's actually here on this page, but try this on your own and see if you can come up with a code, translate that program segment that's displayed, and I'm saying here, if you know anything about programming, try to determine what error somebody typed something in incorrectly. See if you can figure that out. So like I said, always try these examples on your own, off on a separate piece of paper, and then you always have the solved solution in front of you to check your results. It's a great way to study for the test. So that completes chapter 1, and make sure you go back over all the review questions in the chapter. Go back through all the examples, look at the charts, and then solve all the problems at the end of the chapter. There's also 2 or 3 multi-sim applications at the end of chapter 1, too, you need to try. Okay, that's it for now.